Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen. We are going to start our program of the book launch. To start with, we have Qiraat by Brother Abdul Rahman.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu kunu qawwamina lillahi shuhada'a bil qist. Wa la yajrimannakum shana'anu qawmin ala alla ta'dilu. اعدلوا هو أقرب للتقوى واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون.
In the name of Allah, the most kind, the most merciful. O you who have believed, be persistently standing firm for Allah, witnesses injustice, and do not let the hatred of a people prevent you from being just. Be just, that is nearer to righteousness, and fear Allah. Indeed, Allah is acquainted with what you do.
A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. يا أيها الناس إنا خلقناكم من ذكر وأنثى وجعلناكم شعوبا وقبائل لتعارفوا إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم إن الله عليم خبير.
O mankind, indeed we have created you from male and female and made you peoples and tribes that you may know one another. Indeed, the most noble of you in the sight of Allah is the most righteous of you. Indeed, Allah is knowing and acquainted. Jazakumullah khairan.
Thank you, Brother Abdurrahman. Next on the agenda is the welcome speech. I would like to keep it brief. Since we got it slightly started a bit late, I wouldn't like to speak a lot on this. Dr. Ataullah Siddiq, Brother Irfan Iqbal, Brother Mubarak, and our author Lupan Haris, and my secretary Dias, and the audience, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, I take this opportunity to welcome you all for this book launch of Cloud in the Crescent by Brother Lupan Haris. As you know, this event has been organized by Cosmos UK. Cosmos is the Council of Sri Lankan Muslim Organization UK, which is a body, umbrella body, which has got 22 affiliated associations to us from all over UK. The main organization now in London. So we organize this event on behalf of Brother Lupan Haris. Is the former Vice President of Cosmos, presently is the Assistant Secretary of Cosmos. So it was right for us to plan and organize this event, and we are thankful to Brother Mubarak for providing this opportunity to organize this event in SLMC. The book written by Brother Lupan is a well-researched documentary which tells you about the rise and fall of communal politics in Sri Lanka. And the book also underlines the episodes and analyzes the trend relevant to the best and worst time in recent history in Sri Lanka, where good judgment ultimately prevailed and averted the full scale of communal riot in Sri Lanka, which would have been disastrous for us. And if it does happen, Sri Lanka would have been branded as a pariah state, and we would have lost our status in the community of nations. So that is this book as highlighting all that. I will leave the book review to Brother Irfan Iqbal. He will be talking about the book. One or two things I would like to remind the audience. The book, also a humble attempt by Brother Luqman Haris, the author, to document the challenging time of Muslims in Sri Lanka. He has undergoing the recent time and also the problem we faced by the BBS, which is the Bodu Bala Sena. Just to mention the one more other things is about the BBS. I must wonder whether I should thank them or not, because in one way, BBS, as we call it, a yellow-robed soldiers of Buddhism, in one way they have woken up the Muslims in Sri Lanka. Right, it's a wake-up call. So people have now understood to get involved in the civic activities in Sri Lanka. Muslims have been cocooned. They have been hiding. They are in their slumber, you know. So they are in a deep slumber, so which made us get into a proper situation with all these problems cropping up. Now the Muslims have woken up. In one way, we are thankful to the BBS, so that now the Muslims are now involved in civic liberty activities. And on the other hand, also my thanks goes to the professional intellectuals, diplomats, and also the National Front for Good Governance, Najah Mohammed. All these people have practically supported and assisted with the problem cropped up in Sri Lanka. So we are thankful to all of them. And I don't think I'll continue further on this. I want to end my welcome speech by saying it is now time for the Sri Lankan Muslim to find a suitable leader. A leader with a visionary thinking, a leader who can coordinate the existence of Muslims in Sri Lanka and lead them. So this is the thing this is lacking. Since we have got these civil activities started off with all these professionals getting involved in various activities in Sri Lanka, now it's time that we find a visionary leader. So by saying that, I will end my speech, and then I will call upon the next speaker, who is the president of SLMC, Brother Mubarak Junaid of Harrow Mosque, to give his short speech. Thank you.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Nahmadu wa nusalli ala Rasulil Kareem amma ba'd. Dear Chair, Brother Luqman, Brother Rizwan Wahab, the Lias Wahab, Irfan Iqbal, and Dr. Ataullah Siddiq, Brother Luqman Haris, and all the distinguished guests, respected brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. In this gracious program, Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed us to participate, and I take this opportunity to welcome all on behalf of Sri Lanka Muslim Cultural Center. It is very important that we have so much in our history, but many things are not recorded. Not only in Sri Lanka, worldwide, from the beginning, from the time Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam departed this world, for the last 1,400 years, many places, many areas, the histories have been lost because we have not kept enough good records. In Sri Lanka, if you know, after 1980s, there has been a big violent problem 100 years before. And after the war ended in 2009, there has been some, every people know that there has been some serious incidents backed by the government, especially the president and the former Secretary of State, Secretary of Defense. These incidents are very, very important. It is important to record so that we could see what next step we could take, and also we have to safeguard our community, as Brother Rizwan told. Maybe for the good of Muslims that these robe people came, the yellow robes soldiers or whoever came. But it is time to wake up. We have to take proper actions. Actions in two ways. One way is to we have to get more closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Any problem, maybe in Sri Lanka's problem that we had last few years, and also now currently we are going to face this problems in UK and in Europe globally. Muslims are from various places after the attack in Paris. Things are getting worse. Every day when you see the newspapers, you see new things coming up. Yesterday there has been news. They are going to come into the madrasas and masjids. So it is time for that. We have to take two-pronged action, two-sided action. One side is we have to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to see istighfar from Allah for all our sins, first thing. And also we have to increase our worship. We have to increase our good deeds. We have to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We must do our things getting help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And number two, we have to do all peaceful actions, whatever politically, whatever, in other words, peaceful actions that Muslims could take, we should take. And above all, we all must learn to live as a good Muslim. Islam is very precious. Alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed us with, but we have to show that Islam to our other people. For the majority of the people who are outside, Islam means what is being shown in the TV, what is being shown in the media. It is, you know, how badly they are, only the negative side they have been propagating. We as Muslims, we must take a step, we must take determinated action to show that we are good Muslims. Everyone has to live as a role model Muslim, with good akhlaq, with good manners, with upright honesty, with good behavior. Alhamdulillah, if every person behaves like a good Muslim, with patiently, with sabr, with the tenderness, with the softness, how Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dealt with the Makkan kafir. However, with so much of negative things, he was very peaceful, patiently he kept the steps forward. Similarly, we have to act very peacefully. At the same time, we should not lose any of our rights. Not in here, maybe in Sri Lanka, nowhere we should not, whatever the right that we have, whatever the forefathers have got the rights for Muslims, we must try to maintain those rights. In that respect, I think Brother Luqman Haris has put a lot of effort. He has spent a lot of nights. I think the last 4-5 years he has been doing this book. At his initial stages he has been showing in Cosmos. We had, I think, 2-3 times we have seen this. And he was thinking, where I can end this. Alhamdulillah, Allah made the opportunity. Nicely things politically changed in Sri Lanka. So that was, he said, this is the point, I am going to finish this book and I am going to release it. Alhamdulillah, things have been going like a graph, going up. And Alhamdulillah, it has come down. It is on our behavior that how we are going to leave this. It's going up or going down. So Alhamdulillah, if everyone acts very peacefully and request at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we live in a good, peaceful life, things will remain, inshallah, better. I don't want to take more time. There are other speakers to speak, inshallah. Doctor has come from Birmingham all the way. Jazakumullah khairan for giving me the opportunity. May Allah strengthen his feet and may Allah help him to do more work for Sri Lanka and here for the Muslim community. Jazakumullah khairan.
Before we go to the next item, which is a short video presentation by Brother Mehdi, son of Luqman Haris of the Cloud in the Crescent. Columbia launch. Yeah, the book has been already launched in Sri Lanka. Now this is the Columbia launch. So it's going to show some video clipping of the Columbia launch. Before that, just want to add a few more things while the young man is getting ready. Just a few words about Brother Luqman. As I already told that he was the former Vice President and Assistant Secretary for Cosmos. Brother Luqman has been actively involved in multitude of roles. A human rights defender, a social activist, a trade unionist, a charity fundraiser, and an HRM professional. So he has got quite a bit of things going behind him. His significant contribution in the case of human rights as the publication of his 750-page book, The Mirage of Dignity on the Highways of Human Progress, which was published in USA and launched in UK and Sri Lanka. He has been awarded the Service Excellence Award by the Sri Lanka Islamic Forum for his distinguished service to Sri Lankan community. He is also a director of Alliance for Cohesion and Social Equity, Equality in Berkshire. Cosmos is proud to have him as one of our executive member, and he's an asset to our organization. Assalamu alaikum, brothers. Next speech is by our chief guest, Dr. Taula Siddi. Before that, I will make a small introduction. And while reflecting on Amina Thero's speech, it sounds just a reminder of recollecting about Martin Luther King Jr. said he's talking most about various things by majority of people, Sri Lankans, and having the smaller community and not taking much of an action and so on and so forth, and also he's talking a lot about various other things. Just about just noted it down. What Martin Luther King Jr. said is the ultimate tragedy is not the oppression and cruelty by the bad people, but the silence of good people. Just a reminder for all of us. The good people are keeping quiet and the bad people are acting on it. Right, now our next speaker, Dr. Ataullah Siddi. Dr. Ataullah Siddi has got his BA honors. He's a PhD from University of Birmingham, and also he has got an honorary degree, PhD, from University of Gloucestershire. He is presently a reader, religious pluralism and interfaith relation in Markfield University. He is dealing with Christian-Muslim relations, interfaith relation, Islam and pluralism, Islam and the West, Muslim chaplaincy, Islam in South Asia, training of religious leadership, imams and ulamas. So these are his research interest. Dr. Ataullah Siddi is apart from whatever he is mentioned, is also the director of the institute of Markfield Institute from 2001 to 2008. He's a visiting professor of University of Gloucestershire and a visiting fellow of York St. John's University. Is a member of the advisory board of the HRH Prince Al Walid bin Talal Center for the Study of Islam and Contemporary World at the University of Edinburgh. He was the founder president and vice chair of the Christian Muslim Forum in England and a founder member of the Leicester Council of Faith. And he has got a number of publications. I think Dr. Ataullah is going to speak now. I mean, it's going to be very short, right? So I will call upon Dr. Ataullah Siddi to make his presentation. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum. Nahmadu wa nusalli ala rasulihi al-kareem wa ala alihi wa sahabihi ajma'in. First of all, thank you very much for this kind invitation. And I'm here with the Sri Lankan community. And thank you for all guests, all the people who are here. When I was just looking at the video of Amila Thero's presentation, it reminds me of something very important. And that is that in a society where we are living in, where it is important to have Umar, Abu Bakr, Ali, Aisha, Fatima, it is equally important to have Abu Talib. At the time of need, at the time of this sort of difficulties, you also need Abu Talib to look after you, but also give that protection and help. And it's also important that when these things happen to others, we should also become Abu Talib to others. That is the spirit of Islam, and that's what is important. I don't want to read all my papers, everything, that's not my interest, but what I'll try to do is highlight a few points. First of all, today the world is ruled by interest. In politics, nothing is permanent except interest. Neither the transaction you have made, paper you have signed, nothing is permanent except the interest. And in this interest, the group, community, people will always try to see their own interest against the other. And in this part, something which is missing is identity. And there comes the problem. When we talk about identity, immediately you come across with two things. Those identity will demand from you history and memory. Identity comes from those two things. How I have remembered my history, how I have carried my history from generation to generation. That's the problem. Another problem is how I remember my history against the others. These are the two things that we need to resolve, that we need to confront. Here, both in the, what you call in Bosnian crisis, for example, when the people, the neighbor attacked neighbor, they were absolutely good neighbor. They used to have intermarriages. They were very kind to each other. The moment the crisis came, it was immediately evoked history and memory. They didn't say you were bad. They said what you have done 300 years, 400 years ago. They always remember those things. An interesting thing is that we carry those memories and pass it on to next generation. Those things have not been confronted. In our relationship, it is absolutely important that we should develop a relationship where we can open up our problems with the others and other, and listen to the other's problem with together. That is the starting point. I will come to that in a few minutes. When we come to the difficult issue of history and memory, first thing it happens, what happens is to demonize the other. When I do not like you, I will demonize you. And in poetry, in writing, in papers, in talks, we write, we demonize the other person. Once we demonize the other person, we dehumanize the other person. Dehumanization begins. And dehumanization will start with, look, these are the people who have done to us. And therefore, a victimhood starts. So it starts with dehumanization. It starts with demonization, dehumanization, victimization, and then the question is elimination. When the confrontation begins, it is always the problem is that enemy that I can see as an enemy, not as a human being who is no longer human, who is no longer worth taking into care of. He needs to be eliminated. And in our history, we don't need to go to 1,000 years of history. In our history, what we need to look at it is the area of Holocaust here. Tutsi and Hutu. 100 million people killed because we did not confront our fear, our memory, our history with the others. We didn't share that. The openness was important. Rohingya Buddhist crisis is still going on. They didn't say, when you came here, it's not that 2 years ago. It was thousands of years, hundreds of years ago, they came and settled. But when the crisis came, it's a crisis of creation. For example, remember those processions of thousands of Buddhists protesting against the government, giving rights. What happened to that? All of a sudden, that movement turned against Muslims because demonization, dehumanization and victimhood started. And that was the result of the Rohingya Muslims. And I fear the similar thing is happening in Sri Lanka, that the people who arrived with thousands of years of history, those who came here for so many years ago, this book that I have seen now, which I have a quick look, brings out some of the very important point. I like to quote small things here. The demonization aspect. You do not belong here, the book says. You do not belong, he quotes it. And go back to where you came from. Have you heard this before? Yes. Here, elsewhere. You are only a guest here. This book also highlights you are a crows who can fly above our heads, but you cannot build nest on our heads. This book also says we are the coconut state. You are only the subsidiary crops. Country belongs to Sinhala, Sinhalese. Other communities should not make unreasonable claims and demands. The minorities were like the creepers around us. These are the demonization aspect. Demonization brings dehumanization. Dehumanization brings victimhood, and victimhood will say elimination has to be started. Once it is drawn in name of religion, this sort of demonization becomes in the name of religion, it is even more lethal. Because the person who is doing the dehumanization and elimination believes his holiness, believes that he will be rewarded for that, and believes that whether it succeeds or not, at least I'm in Jannah. At least I'm in heaven. Now that is even more lethal. So when we try to ethnic cleansing, cultural exploitation, when it comes with the religion, it is even worse. So that religious aspect is very, very important part. Remember today, the modernity, the created out of enlightenment, secularization, etc., has no answer to how. They only answer how, but they do not answer why. Science and social sciences give you pie and charts, but not life-changing stories and its meaning and make sense of it. A respectful, dignified, plural society cannot be created on the basis of hate of other human beings. In order to remove hate, one has to remove hate from their heart. And that is the important part. And here, we are all reminded by the Quranic injunction that the dignity of human is non-negotiable. If we want that our dignity to be secured, we have to give the assurance that their dignity is also safe and secure in our hands. What to do now? I will conclude with few sentences. What to do? Ask an important question. Are our mosques places of hope? Simple question. As a Muslim, let us ask this question. Are our mosques today places of hope? I'm trying this the last 3 years in my class, asking my students, tell me your mosque is a place of hope, not only for Muslims, but also for widow, for the drug addicts, for the people who are harmed themselves, for children who has been abused, and your Muslim, non-Muslim neighbors. Is our mosque places of hope? Last 3 years, I haven't heard a single word saying yes. Nobody said that. Unless our mosques are places of hope, we need to rethink what we are doing. That is our challenge. One example I will give you. In Gujarat, thousands of Muslims were killed in 2002-2003. And in that aspect, there is a one incident, one thing that has come to me. I heard this somebody sent me this link. One of the well-known imam goes to that place after years later and says, I want to meet the person who instigated the killing of Muslims. I want to have talked to him. And this, he found a mediator and he brought this person in hiding. He is hiding in this part and he comes to see him. And this great imam asks him, what is wrong? Why you have done this? The example that he gave is very important. He said, here I am. We come from a lower caste. We come from a poor area. And this is a wonderful, beautiful mosque here. Every other day I see Mercedes is coming, expensive cars are coming, they are having food after food, they are having dinner after dinner, and right in front of us, what is left over, they are thrown in front of us. And next door neighbor, they're extremely poor. They can't afford one meal a day. And here is the mosque living in luxury. I started that, I resented that. And therefore I started an anti-Muslim agenda. I have asked to help me and the very strong non-Muslim, the fanatical, the BBS type people came, helped us, and remember what I said before, demonize, dehumanize, victimize, and eliminate. And that's what they did, and try to eliminate Muslims from there. We need to think too, what are we doing? Here we need to have bilateral relationship. When you need to talk to the other people, please empathize, sympathize what this person is feeling about you. Listen carefully. You see, listen carefully what this person has to say. Empathize, and then relate yourself with that. And in my experience, it helps a lot. Because the other person thinks you are sincere, and you should be sincere. Thinking about that, and relate with each other, and create a new society, and it is possible. Let us think again that we should not be the victim of creating ourselves, demonizing others, dehumanizing others, victimizing ourselves and trying to eliminate the others. If we do not want that, we should not be expecting from others too. Thank you very much.
Sakala Hiran, brother and Dr. Atawala Siddiq. It indeed inspiring speech, which will enlighten our audience today and also the Muslims all over. Being a professor and a director of Mahfield University, I believe that is a guiding light for the Muslims in the United Kingdom. And just the last few points, which is very important for us to know. I myself also very keen, the masjid, the mosque, will encourage people to come for activities and involve them in various activities rather than just having their normal prayers and gathering for Friday prayers. It is a hope, as you said, a place to encourage people in need. People have been abused, the widows, young people to come and gather, talk, sort out their problem and issues and bring this as a meeting place. I myself is encouraging our own mosque to involve themselves in activities and use the place available to support and encourage the local community, not only the Muslims, but also the non-Muslims, and integrate with the society and join with them, and so that we solve our problem and solve their problem as well. In addition to that, he was also talking about the wastage of food by the mosque and the luxury life mosques are involved in and entertaining themselves, where the neighbors are poor or they are unable to feed themselves. So that is an encouraging thing for the mosque to know that not to waste the food and also help their neighbors rather than just cocoon themselves into their own bell and hiding away and getting try and see that our Muslims are going to do the best. But it's not so. As far as Dr. Taula has just said, it is very, very important to all of us, the Muslims in UK, to join together and work together in harmony and not to demonize and also not to be the victims. And he said so, that being a victim, why? The reason we are being victim, because our own activity, our own actions, what we do here, we are not practicing or we are not behaving ourselves in a right manner for them to come and believe us that he is a true Muslim, then he is the man who is going to support us and help us, and he is going to be the one who is going to support us. Anyway, so it's a long speech, but I have just few points just to for us to know the masjid, the mosque and the madrasas, to know that we must get involved, we must join together, we must support each other, not only for our own community but community at large. This way in UK we the Muslims can proudly stand up and walk without any problem, any issues. If you work with the people, the reason that we are not being, we have been told a few things what doctor said about Muslims, go back to your own country, this is not your country. He said about the coconut tree in Sri Lanka. You know, the same thing happened to us in UK here. At many occasions people tell us, go back to your own country, you are not, you don't belong here. The reason is that we are not integrated, we are not with the people. We must be with the people, we must work for the people, not only for our own community. We are just cocooned, we have been hiding away, and we are in deep slumber here, to say it in a simple manner. We must wake up. The reality, the issues what happened in Paris, right, things are happening now to madrasas, what Brother Mubarak has said. So all these, the reason is that we are not doing our best. Every single Muslim in this country has been identified as a possible, they could say Muslims are terrorists or terrorists are Muslim, we don't know. That's what they keep saying. Either the terrorists are Muslim or the Muslims are terrorists, we don't know. So this is what they're trying to say. So we must be more careful and integrate ourselves, make sure we do our best. Now, Brother Luqman is going to make a presentation to Dr. Taula before our next speaker, Brother Irfan Iqbal. He will be reviewing the book that I will come back for them. Next speaker is Brother Irfan Iqbal. He is also one of our Cosmos members. He's been a long-standing founder member as well. He will be reviewing the book for Brother Luqman. He is a journalist. Brother Luqman, Brother Irfan is in the field of writing since 1985. He started writing essays, short stories for local newspapers from his childhood. In 1988, he started handwritten newspaper newspaper in school called Papada. In 1989 and 91, he was the editor of various school magazines. 1990, he was the sub-editor of Marshall A. and Selvam National Children Magazine. From 1997 to 2007, Mr. Irfan was a radio jockey producer in Sri Lanka, Singapore, UK and in India. 2000, he joined the World Radio Network in the UK. In 2002, he founded Milab One of the first, I'm sure I couldn't pronounce that, of the first online Tamil radio. Again in 2002, he founded the long-standing Tamil literature forum, Nilamutram. 2004, he was a founder member of the European Tamil Broadcasting Corporation. And 2011, he founded the presently running sonar.com in a wake of documenting Sri Lankan Muslims, Moors we call it, history. 2013, he founded Muslim Kural. You know the rest. I mean, most of our audience, the Sri Lankan audience, will know what I'm talking about. Other activities also, his social activities, and he was a human rights activist as well. I now call upon Brother Irfan Iqbal to review Brother Luqman Harris's Cloud in the Crescent. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum to everyone. Jazakallah for your kind presence here. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. First of all, my warm welcome to distinguished guest, Dr. Ataullah Siddiqui, as well as the president of Sri Lankan Muslim Cultural Center here, which we call the Arrow Mosque, Brother Mubarak Junaideen, and the secretary of the Cosmos, Brother Liaz, as well as the chairman, Brother Rizwan, and along with all of you ladies and gentlemen, the author of the book, Brother Luqman Harris. First of all, my congratulations to Brother Luqman Harris. The book I'm going to review now is the one I'm holding here. It's quite a big document. I think reasonably there are around 493 pages at least. So it is quite impossible for us to review page by page. But I think it is time for me to point out a few things which you may find interesting and which may also bring your attention and make you read this important piece of document, especially during these days where we're just feeling relieved after a huge trauma that we went through back in Sri Lanka as well as here, being Sri Lankans. Now, first of all, in order to start, I'm going to start with page number 60, where he has rightly included a quote from a reader to Daily News, I guess, whereas a reader has written the letter to the editor saying, quoting ex-president Chandrika Bandar Naik Kumarasinghe, that she admitted her father has made a mistake by bringing out the Sinhala only policy in Sri Lanka. I think that adds the essence to this book, which is a point rightly put forward. And we also have to remember, in the same Daily News Plus, there is a magazine called Daily News Plus, and their 50th anniversary magazine, which was released on, I think, 1st of February, 1998. In that, they included another quote from the very first Prime Minister of Sri Lanka, Mr. D.S. Senanayake, whereas he says, the Sri Lankan Moors existed in the country as long as there is history for Sinhalese Buddhists. Now, what you have to take up on this issue is that he was the first Prime Minister and he was well aware of our existence. And the name Moors, we were given this name by the Portuguese when they arrived in late 15th century because of the symbolic similarities they found within us, for our forefathers, ancestors. They named us Moors for some reason. Since then, the name Moors exists. Still, even you go to North or East, wherever you go in Sri Lanka, you will find somehow there will be a street called Moor Street. Somehow there will be a street. In Colombo, central Colombo, there are two streets. One is Old Moor Street another one is New Moore Street. There are two parts of it. So the name Moore's was given to us. I mean, it's not an issue. What I'm trying to say is, understanding our existence is very important for us. In order to counter things, now why is that important for Brother Luqman Harris to write a piece of document like this? What it is exactly? What has he gone through? What has he compiled? There are many questions you should ask. I'm very glad that we have such a number of people turn out today here. It is the same in Sri Lanka as well. If you go to a book release, there will be a certain people turning around for every book release. And there will be a few guests. They will appear for every book release and they will be releasing it. They will be having the first copy because only few people are interested. Like that, the world of literature is open for us, but we are not ready for it. That is the important part here. So what has he done? The first question. Has he just collected information throughout the years and just composed or copied and made it a book? If you think that way, what is the purpose? He's not going to gain anything. Even if you pay £12 for this, he's not going to gain for this. The way I look at it, it is an important piece of evidence, history. Let's put that way, it is a history. What he has done is an important work that needs to be done in the history. As you guys know, we are very much involved. My brother, my well-wisher, the man who pushed me always, Solicitor Mohammed Nistar, he is here as well. You all know at least our names. We've been involved in these matters for long. And to be honest, although I'm a journalist and I'm having contact with almost every single journalist back home in every field, I'm still continuing to write my experience on those days. That's been published in local papers, but still writing, haven't completed it. But Brother Luqman has completed it. So it is an achievement. First of all, my congratulations for achieving that, Brother Luqman. And then I will jump onto the contents without taking much of your time. I would like to start with chapter 3 in the book. The reason being the title or the subtopic, where he rightfully asked, are Muslims aliens in Sri Lanka? I think it is an interesting topic. I don't think it is just relating to us. Even the Sinhalese has to read that. Muslims has to read that. Every single Sri Lankan citizen has to read that. Are Muslims aliens in Sri Lanka? Well, of course, I think it is a doubt even within us, among us. How many of us know our history? How many of us know where did we come from? Or what sort of indigenous connection we have in this society or in our motherland? Those are questions we don't actually look upon because our lifestyle, like Dr. pointed out, is very much restricted. We have a circle within which we are satisfied because our end goal is something else. So we don't think that we consider these are world matters. But these world matters come into prominence and are useful when the right situation arises. Then we search for the channels. Who can do this? Who can do that? We search for the channel. In Sri Lanka, just an information, the Sri Lankan Muslim Media Forum, there is an organization called Sri Lankan Muslim Media Forum. There is around 550 members at least actively paying subscription. How many of them were able to come forward and expose what was happening in Sri Lanka during the conflict? How many of them were available? Were they available to do? Can they do? Or did they have that training? Was the situation politically allowing them to do? There are many questions which we may not find answers, to be honest. But then when the need is there, if we do have the ability and the expertise, we have to show up. So I'm very glad there is another gentleman called Mr. M.I.M. Mohideen. He completed a book as well. But it was mostly based on the incidents surrounding to Alutgamai issues, I think. Most of the photographs which he included. Then again, there is another person, I think Brother Ansa. He composed a book as well. He finished it. And that is again with the Alutgamai incidents. But what Brother Lukman has done is beyond that. He has kept his wings very much open. He has traveled through different paths. I was very interested. I took around 1 hour every day for the past 30 or 20 days or so. Every day, 1 hour, I just look at, okay, if I miss anything, I go back and see what this guy has done. Because I'm a kind of person who search for perfection. And being royalist, he's an old royalist as well. So fellow royalists should have done better things. So I was much interested in that. So I actually noticed that he has kept his wings very much open. He has traveled through different paths and collected information, including history. He has rightfully included one person, quotes about one person called Lona Devaraja. I'm very thankful for Brother Lukman to include about Lona's commitment and Lona's concern about the Sri Lankan Muslim community. Whereas our people are really not prepared or either not doing anything beyond the 1,000 years bracket. We are very much scared to go beyond that because we want to maintain the Muslim identity. Of course, that is our identity. There is no harm on that. But one thing what we have to agree is, I hope Dr. can agree as well, who were the Arabs before Islam? We limit ourselves. We think, okay, we are Muslims. When did Islam come to Sri Lanka? It was in late 9th century, okay. We should not be going beyond that. But Lona bravely goes behind that. But none of the Muslim authors, including, there are a couple of authors actually, they have done a tremendous amount of work all up to that 9th century, not beyond that. They have done a good job. Including Dr. Shukri, which has been appointed here as well. And I would like to mention Professor Anas, MSM Anas. He talks a lot, but where he missed to come into the national field is that he restricted himself within his region. He comes from Putlam, so he didn't extend his work. Then Dr. Jamil, a very grateful guy from Eastern Province. And then you count on, there is another book release in Martale. All these people did something, but they restricted very much within the 1,000 years bracket because they don't want to go beyond that. They don't want to research who we are. But it has to be done. I wish Brother Lukman, this important piece of document, made some sort of research about that. And went on to talk about it. But then within his limitation and the information that he would like to put on it, within his topic, saying that clouding the crescent in Sri Lanka, the title itself talks that it is about the recent events. For many, many people, I would say more than 60% of the people, what happened from 2013, it's a new thing. They thought it is a new thing. And then in 2014, some people thought, no, this is something continuing from 1915, because Jatika Hela Urimeya, the godfathers of Bodu Bala Sena, who we always talk about, they challenged that they will make sure another centenary riot will appear in 2015. So where we got alerted, we thought, no, you deal with it and we deal with it. Groundwork. There was a lot of groundwork needed. Then now people started thinking, all right, this is something continuing. for few, they have no knowledge. But then I would say, I don't think any of you know, even the 1915 riot was another centenary riot of 1815. How many of you know that history? In 1815, when British started ruling, when they said, we are to take over your country, when the Sinhalese kingdom was restricted within the Kandy area, the hill country area, who did the British send to the Midlands or the hill lands? There were 10 Muslim traders. They went in, they wanted to do a peaceful trading, try it out, but unfortunately they were murdered in Gampola. I don't think any of our people go back and notice these things. Out of those 10, 3 managed to escape with wounds, but then later died. So then again, 1915 was in connection. When the century year came, they started escalating. I've seen, I also read in Brother Lukman's book that he has touched that part with several other people's quotes. Not his own opinion, but other people's quote. In one of the quotes, I really saw people saying the Kandy issue in 1915 war escalated by coastal Moors. Some people say that. I really disagree with that. What is that, coastal Moors? Either call us Moors or call us Muslims. Where did this term coastal Moor came from? A man called Pon Ramanathan, when the Royal Asiatic Society, when the East India Company, the British companies was ruling there, the Royal Asiatic Society was conducting a survey about the minorities in all the countries they ruled. They did that in Sri Lanka as well. So they wanted to know, who are these Moors? Then Pon Ramanathan, he was in the Higher Education Society, because our people, as usual, even right now, our literature level is very low. Our people don't go beyond certain limit. We think doing business is fine, alhamdulillah. We do the business, we do our prayers, we look after our kids, fine. We have certain limitations. There are intelligent intellectuals in our community. Some of them are here. Some of them don't even care about our community because of their bad experience. I can name many. They all are in contact with us. The book also refers to few people, but not much. I wish the author did go through that extent as well in order to bring people. There are lots of things that you can talk about, but then he has touched it. I'm glad that he has touched it. He has touched the opinion there. And then this Pon Ramanathan, when he presented to the Royal Asiatic Society that there is no race called Moors exist in the Sri Lanka, only Tamils. Because they speak Tamil, well, of course, we spoke Tamil. But how many of you knew that when the Portuguese came, the first thing they did was look back at the history, go to Portuguese history or British library, search for it. The first thing they did was, when they landed in Sri Lanka, destroy the people who they called Moors, destroy Moors literature. So what literature was that? In which language did we have that literature? Search for it. This is not the stage for me to discuss that, but search for it. At least take that point and search for it. In which language did we have the literature? So where is that language now? How did that got destroyed, erased from the history? Now 600 years ago, I'm talking about. It's erased. We don't know, we don't go back. But in important situations like this, it is a must for us to, when we prepare documents like this, it is a must for us to go through certain things. I think rightly, Brother Lukman has done the right job. Within his limitations and within his topic, the topic that he is discussing, he has rightly gone within the limitation. So, in adding the flavor, I was actually, while reading this, I was expecting some other things, like mentions about Dr. A.M. Aziz and Dr. I.L.M. Abdulaziz. Sorry, he's not a doctor, I.L.M. Abdulaziz, he's a solicitor. And to be honest, when Brother Rizwan was talking, and Brother Mubarak was talking in his speech as well, he was mentioning about the rights of Muslims, Sri Lankan Muslims. Well, if ILM Abdul Aziz wasn't there, I don't think any of us will be enjoying any rights here. But nobody knows who is ILM Abdul Aziz. AM Aziz is known because he existed in the modern era. How many of us know about ILM Abdul Aziz? Search for him. Who was he? What he did for us? Now, how many of us are, I don't know about even my age people or younger people, they might even not know Siddhi Leba. Not many of us know Siddhi Leba. Who was he? The reason being, our community doesn't take anything instantly. They take time. They take a long time to observe and absorb things. They take a long time. During the conflicts in 2013, I remember Professor Tariq Ramadan, I was in touch with him for around 5 days or so, continuously. I was asking him to make a presentation about coexistence, which Dr. minimized today and spoke about. Coexistence, the way Islam promotes coexistence, I asked him. But frankly speaking, he had no idea who the Sri Lankan Muslims were. So he couldn't talk. But then this year, after 2 years, he went to Sri Lanka and spoke the same topic. I'm glad. He took time. After 2 years, he went to Sri Lanka and talked about it. This is how, when the community-oriented things happen, our people take a long time, like that. Brother Luqman's work today will be somehow recognized in history. I'm very much confident on that, because the amount of information that he has collected is tremendous. Look at the, now you may, all of you may be using social medias. You may be definitely using social media. You may see some hated message in one of the Facebook pages or one of the guy's comments or in a profile. But how many of you remember that link? What he has done? When he sees that, he has copied or he has remembered that link, kept it for records, shown it to you, which you might have missed it. In that sense, this is a historical piece of evidence which you can have in your houses, teach your children, and keep it as a lesson. Let the people know what happened in the past. So I think I should not be going deeply inside, but we just have to make sure that right now, we are enjoying a good governance. They call it Yahapalni in Sinhalese. Because of many people's efforts, the book has identified many people's efforts and recorded some of them. But there are a few others actually not recorded in this book. I think I have a duty to tell you guys, which even Brother Luqman doesn't know, I guess, because they were working behind the screen. Most of us, they were working behind the screen. But then when the right time came, they all worked together, they put their efforts. We had a team, communication, interaction. How many of you know, how did our people come out to file a case against Nyanasara, the BBS head monk? He's still telling that, isn't it? Even the last, his press conference, he was quoting this Ratnathera, Athuralia Ratnathera, and asking, Athuralia is in the government side, we are talking for the Buddhists and facing court cases. How did that happen? Who is behind that? Who gave the push? Who gave the power? Who sponsored? There are many people. I will at least have to bring forward one name, Shiraz Nurdin. I will have to be, the community has to be very thankful for him and his team. As soon as the Algam incident happened, they formed a team of solicitors called Rapid Response Team, RRT. And they attend every single court case against the Muslims or filed by Muslim free of charge, including Maitri Gunaratna. Today, Nyanasara, if you let Nyanasara to do something for anyone in Sri Lanka freely, the first target will be Maitri Gunaratna, a solicitor, a Sinhalese solicitor. the love they have for our community, for a peace-loving people. For those peace-loving people to extend it to the future generation, I think these are the must work. But it should not be restricted here. We need more people, more authors like Brother Luqman, more documentation, and we have to complete it. So I think it is a great honor to be here, and it is time all people, every single person attending here, think about it, teach something to your next generation children, and ask them to learn things surrounding your community. Spend a little time for these works, because the voice generated here is more powerful than what they are doing in Sri Lanka. We'll understand this inshallah if we meet in another day. We can talk about it later, but that at this point I would like to be very thankful for Brother Luqman on behalf of the community for compiling such a wonderful piece of book. I would call it a historical evidence. Keep it safe. Whenever you get time, read it. Thankful, and may Allah bless him and protect him, give him long life. Jazakallah.
This presentation by Luqman R is to
Jazakallah Khairan. Thank you very much, Brother Irfan Iqbal, for your excellent manner that you reviewed Cloud in the Crescent and enlightening us on issues of various important to us, to the Muslims here in the diaspora, to know. Apart from what Brother Luqman has written, in addition to that, you have mentioned a few things that the Muslims, that we myself is unaware of. And I'm glad that he has informed us about these things, and also explaining various events and activities Brother Luqman has mentioned in his book, and the tacit support by the previous regime of the previous government supporting the BBS for the disastrous activities of the BBS in Sri Lanka, and the things happened to the Muslims in Sri Lanka. So now the book is available at £12. It's an interesting book for you to keep it in your house and read. So I'm not going to go into detail of what Brother Irfan has said, all of it, because of time constraint as well. So the next item is a short speech by the author, Brother Luqman. It will be followed by a video clip as well. So we'll try to finish before Isha, if we can try and speed up our matter so that we can complete all items we have in agenda. So I now call upon Brother Luqman Haris, the author of Cloud in the Crescent, to come forward for a short speech. Thank you. Yeah. Sorry, before that, Brother Lias, our secretary, will give a profile of Brother Luqman.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Mr. Chairman, Brother Luqman, Brother Mubarak, and our author Luqman Haris. It's the hardest part of the introduction, because I need to introduce Brother Luqman Haris. I started to look into his profile. I started to write nearly 10 pages. I'm not going to do everything now because of the limitation of the time. I'll briefly introduce him, inshallah. He born in Galle, educated at St. Aloysius College, Galle, and Royal College, Colombo as well. His parents are, his father, MSM Haris, was a well-known linguist, master teacher, lecturer, and a Tamil poet as well. Luqman has been a social service even from his young days. He was a forefront in Ahadiya school work and also general secretary for Galle Muslim Cultural Association. He attended the National Day celebration in Iran in 1981 as a state guest. I have plenty of things to go through. I'm afraid we have enough time. All this I'll brief about his the previous the book. Previous book, he has been an accomplished author in 2012. He authored a book in called Mirage Dignity on the Highway of Human Progress, which was published in USA and launched in UK and Sri Lanka as well. In the book review was done by Amin Isadin, deputy editor of Sunday Times, wrote this Lukman Haris by his great scholarly work stands together with history, great idealistic such as Aldous Huxley, Harold Pinter, Thomas Paine, Mohandas Gandhi, Martin Luther King, and Nelson Mandela. The next, this book was mentioned on London Book Review and has received many calls on book review and quoted in works on right issues. And also he's a human rights activist he's a part of COSMOS. He was a deputy president and then now he's assistant secretary. He's more very well introduced, involved in our day-to-day activities. And also I encourage everyone to buy his books, inshallah, before you go. I'll welcome Mr. Lukman Haris to give a brief short talk.
Alhamdulillah, assalamu alaikum, Muhammad bin Abdullah, Mahabad. Respected members of the head table, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I know Brother Lias will at the end thank all of you in a vote of thanks, but on my own behalf, let me thank these distinguished guests who have found time to be here, both at the head table as well as in my front, my sisters as well, for having, you know, sacrificed their afternoon on a Saturday and to be with us today. May Allah bless you and may Allah reward you immensely for that. Ladies and gentlemen, my book is not about religions or critique of religions or races. This book is not about the fact that we have faced in Sri Lanka, not only about that. But my book, my dear friends, is all about the man, the human being that Allah Jalla Shana Salah created and said in Surah 3, لَكَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمِ. Verily we have created you in the best of forms, and Allah continues to say that, but it was man who has made him to the lowest of low. So it is up to us to think what has made what we hear about the human beings. To what extent is the life, the sanctity of life, is being debased in today's world, let alone the Muslims, but even non-Muslims and in general humanity. How much of humanity has been debased today, wherever we see? Muslims are today's target, no doubt, but then Rasul said at that time, why we are so? Why Muslims are being treated like the dirt or the, you know, foam floating on the sea? Because of what is called wahan. Wahan is the love for, you know, the world and the ignoring the hereafter or the death. So ladies and gentlemen, to focus on the, because I have very less time, let me tell you about a story that will highlight why we need to work on this very valuable creation of Allah, the human being. Right? For in my the former book that I wrote, The Mirage of Dignity on the Heights of Highways of Human Progress, what I did was I was analyzing the gaping gap between what has been offered today as human rights by United Nations and various other world bodies, between them and what are the ground realities that our human beings are, you know, facing in the four corners of the world. So there's a widening gap. What is rhetoric, what has been given in books, remains in books, but what's what's happening in the ground level is something different. So my story is this. There was a child who was given a map of the world, a world map, by his dad, just to be of educational value. So this play, because of this, his childly, you know, gimmicks, what he did was, he actually did what some child will do. He tore it into pieces. Because after he tore it. When the dad saw this, he was actually infuriated. He was very much angry with his child. Why did you do this? When I gave you something, why did you do this? And he gave him a challenge. Look, my dear son, if you don't put this back to shape, if you don't put this world map back to shape, means put it right, I will not buy you anything else. So the child took this message very seriously, and he got on to the job. But strangely enough, the dad saw this, actually he came, he went on his some work and came back to see, within certain minutes, he has done this book, the world map back to shape, he has pasted it. So the dad was very much surprised. And he naturally asked his son, how do you do this? You don't know about the world. You don't know about where the America and Africa should be in this map. But still you managed to do it very well. Do tell me, my dear son, how do you do this? You know, he said, you know, dad, I was very curious when you gave me this world map. And I, with my childly, you know, curiosity, I was looking both sides of this map. On one side, true, you had this world map. But on the other side, I saw a picture of a man. So I didn't want to do anything to the world. So what I did was, I put all my effort to put this man back to shape, which is known to me. Once I did that, I turned the side on the other side of the map, the page, there came the whole map back to shape. So my dear brothers and sisters, this is a very good message. We see loads of things being, as Dr. Ataullah pointed out, humanized, dehumanized, and we are also getting into ghettos, thinking in terms of Muslims as Muslims, Buddhists and Buddhists, and we are getting into ghetto shape, where Allah Jalla Shanahu wa Ta'ala very clearly said in the beautiful Quran ayat that was quoted at the end of this, beginning of this program, right? Allah says in the Quran, Ya Yuhannas, O mankind, Allah would have said, O Ya Yuhallazina Amanu, O those who believe. But He didn't say that. He said, Ya Yuhannas, O mankind, right? Allah says that we created you from a man and a woman, right? So that, litarafu, so that you can identify each other, know each other, not to despise each other. So we forget this message. When someone is asking for charity, we go only to a Muslim and give it as charity. And that is not that. Because Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent as a mercy into mankind. And that was a message. So this book is all about the evil nature of the man. So that was, Quran speaks about it. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about it. The Lord, the Buddha, is very rightly put out that hatred, nehivaira vairani, that means the hate does not, you know, cease with hatred, but with love and kindness. In Bible, Jesus Christ, they may peace be upon him. In the Bible version, it's quoted, love thy neighbor as yourself. So these are things that are coming up. Even I quoted in the Colombo book launch, a kavi by a very important kavi book, you know, which is called the Subhashita. Right, Subhashita is a very important literal masterpiece in Sinhala literature. Where that Mukhavati, that was a big poet, very, very famed poet, right? He was talking about this subject of hate. Why hate actually kills man? He talked Ludruk Masikalange Valagehiage, so which means the insects, the flies you see, is actually, it has only poison at the tip of their, you know, flap. But then, right, Napuru, he was talking about the people, right? The people of evil disposition, they have poison in all over the body. And that's why, my dear brothers and sisters, which happened in Sri Lanka. So as this learned speaker pointed out, that's a work of force for Muslims as well. So this book is not a mold about a community. It's not about, person about community. I did a lot of work and put all those things what the hate groups did, but it's more than that. It's much more a wake-up call for our Muslims to be interactive, integrated with the community, and work for man. More that we work for the men, mankind, right? Then other communities will turn towards Islam, and there is no need for us to, preach Islam. Islam, let us be good ambassadors for the great deen. Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was our model. So let us show through our own ways how you treat our friends, and they should see Islam in our own behavior. So ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, so I'm sure you will carry with you a book, copy of the book, and invest. I didn't even bet two eyelids in investing in this book, because I thought this is something which is lacking in Muslim community, to put things on paper, to put in writing, so that the next generation, 10 years later, when the researchers are researching into what happened in 2013, 2014, they will not just go for certain books written by the minister Champaka Ranawaka in Sri Lanka, Halal or Haram, Al-Qaeda, Al-Jihad. So they will go into documents which are written by authors like Latif Farooq, who has done a lot of work. He has put a lot of money for this. So likewise, I thought it is it's just a small effort, initiative to invest my time and energy. And I must thankful to my beloved wife and my children also for being cooperative and giving me time, quality time. In fact, my wife used to call this book has almost become your second wife. So I always tell, so it's the same treatment. So it is actually something which is actually in us. My father did this and he passed on to me. He said, this is what, I'll finish it with this quote. When I started my O-levels to do, in fact, Allah gave me this one, I was able to pass GC O-levels in both languages, single and English. So when I was doing a lot of social work, Ahadiyah and various other movements, when I was doing O-levels, a lot of my friends, their parents said, stop all those work. You got to do your studies. When I asked the same question for my dad, he said, don't do that, right? You continue with what you are doing, because Allah will bless you. And he gave me one example. And ladies and gentlemen, I will quote that example and finish my speech. He said, look, when you wash your clothes with soap, right? You wash your clothes with soap with one intention. That is to clean the clothes. That was the intention. But at the end of the whole process, when you have washed the clothes, look at both of your hands. Hasn't it got cleaned as well? Right? Did you start your process of washing the clothes expecting your hands to be clean? No. Your intention was to clean the clothes. But at the process, at the end of it, both your hands also got cleaned up. So this was the example he gave me, said, when you do things for others, Allah in his infinite mercy will bless you with whatever intention or objectives and vision you have in your life. So may Allah bless us all this and make us Muslims as ambassadors, rather than just being, like others. I'm just another. No, we need to make some change. And that change should start from our own self, our families, and also for the community. Whatever we do, we must do ourselves. If you can't do it, help those people who can do things. So, my dear brothers and sisters, Jazakallah khair for coming here. I'm very grateful that we have a very good crowd here. So, this message should go out to our communities. And we should not bring divisions. So, I always say, when we come from Sri Lanka, sometimes we have a baggage allowance of 35 kilos or 30 kilos. 1 kilo, we bring all those sectarian differences from Sri Lanka and spread here. This is not good. right? Our baggage, you know, let us keep the baggage to bring our own things, not to bring all these differences. So here we say that this and this, lot of things. So we should be united first of all. So that is one reason why BBS in Sri Lanka was quoting, you know, various various types of organizations with precise details. Who gave you this? Who gave them to protest that in this? And when we show our differences, naturally they will actually expect. So ladies and gentlemen, Jazakallah khair for Cosmos for organizing this. Jazakallah khair for Dr. Ataullah for making the journey from there at our invitation. Jazakallah khair for Mr. Irfan Iqbal for having done this. A lot of brothers were involved for this, and all these brothers who have expressed. So may Allah accept our effort which we have done in his deen. And also I must thank my third son, the youngest son, for having done this video, which you will see how much it summarizes my book. It is in that video.
Thank you very much, Mr. Lukman Adharis. Due to time constraint, I'm not going to go into detail of what Lukman Adharis has said. Of course, it will be heartening to know the story he told about the child and the world map. I'm sure it will be in the heart of all our members. And also the story about his father and what he said to him. So those are things that is a learning curve for all of us. And he said it's a small effort in this book, but I think it's a big jump for the Sri Lankan Muslims, the Muslims of the United Kingdom, as well as the rest of the world. This book is eye-opener and a wake-up call to the Muslims to know the history of Sri Lankan Muslim, and also to get about forgetting about their ghettos and forget about worrying about themselves, come back to the society, work together and work in harmony. So this is what all of us are looking forward to. And so this book should be read by everybody. As I said, the book will be launched and it will be available immediately while the refreshment will be going on in a few minutes. Now the next item of the agenda is the video clipping, but I think due to the time constraint and the Isha prayer coming at 7:30, I will be having the item number 8 now, and then the video will go on later on while we are having refreshments so we all can sit. Isha is 8 o'clock. Isha is... Azad. All right, okay. Right, now we will have our vote of thanks and then we will follow with the video clipping. I now call upon Brother Lias Abdul Wahid, our Secretary of Cosmos, too, for the vote of thanks.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Almost done. Honorable Chairman Mr. Rizwan Wahab, Cosmos UK, Honorable Guest Speaker Dr. Ataullah Siddiqui, readers in religious pluralism and interfaith relations, Markfield Institution of Higher Education, respected guest Brother Irfan Iqbal, editorsonar.com, Mr. Junaid Mubarak, President SLMCC Harrow, Mr. Lukman Haris, of course, author, valued invited guests, ladies and gentlemen, it is my privilege, to great honor, to have been asked to propose vote of thanks on this occasion. Alhamdulillah. On behalf of Cosmos UK and entire team, wish to extend a very hearty vote of thanks to the guest speaker, Dr. Ataullah Siddiqui, who find time of his busy schedule to be with us here, share valuable thoughts with us and the team, peaceful coexistence in multi-religious societies. We enjoyed your wonderful speech. It was so relevant to the Brother Rukman Haris book. Will be long remembered. Many thanks. May Allah bless you. I would like to take this opportunity to thank Mr. Irfan Iqbal, who is also part of our Cosmos UK, offered a review of the book at today's event for the benefit of the audience in a very effective manner. We thank him too. Also may I express our sincere thanks for him giving excellent coverage of this book. Look, this book launch in the online news website, sonar.com. Ladies and gentlemen, our chairman, Mr. Rizwan Wahab, has been driving forces behind this whole process. His vision, interested and hardworking, has gone once again, culminated in another success story. I wish to thank him for the whole leadership on this event. We also wish Dr. Rafiq Nalimi, who took this initiative to speak to Dr. Ataunla in this regard. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Lukman Haris, the author of The Clouding, The Crescent in Sri Lanka, we thank for his manner, his masterpiece of the work on writing this book. We honor him for all his hard work and dedication. He's a wonderful role model for our new generation. We are also inspired by your work, Mr. Haris. May I thank on behalf of the whole community for your wonderful, hard-working job for writing this book. Big thank you, sir. I also extend my thanks to Mr. Junaidi Mubarak, President of Sri Lanka Muslim Cultural Center and Board of Trustees, Haromos, for having readily offered us the use of premises of this event and the support in his regard. Many thanks for giving all these facilities to us to launch this book. I'm also very grateful, Mr. Ubaidur Rahman, for his contribution being a part of organizing committee and organizing the food and refreshment, which is very important. Well, Mr. Chairman, guest of honor, ladies and gentlemen, an event like this cannot happen overnight. The wheels started rolling weeks ago. It requires planning, bright eyes for details. We have been fortunate enough to, backed by our executive committee of COSMOS, dedicated volunteers, all community leaders, chairpersons of all affiliated organizations, Sri Lanka most trustees in UK, media such as Sonar.com, Jaffna Muslim, Madaval News, etc. And also lots of families, families and friends who done wonderful job to make this event success. We thank them all. And also Mr. Lukman's son, Mehdi Haris, for IT support and the producing the videos. Finally, very important vote of thanks goes to all invitees. We understand you have taken time out for your busy schedule to witness being part of successful event. Some of you have been traveled from long way. Sincere gratitude and appreciation to all of you who have raised this event with your presence today. Alhamdulillah, thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you, Brother Lukman, for the vote of thanks. Our next item is the short video about the book, and after that it will be followed by signing of the book by the author and the audience. I urge them to buy the book, and then it will be continued with our refreshment and end of the event. Okay, that's fine. Brother Lukman is saying that the audience that will be buying the books, and then of course the author will personally sign the book afterwards. Thank you very much. Now Brother Mehdi will show you a short video about the book.